أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، dear viewers, my respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have stepped into the 50th episode of our series, the series titled as Mercy to Mankind. The series regarding the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this episode, inshallah, we'll continue with the story of the battle of the conquest of Makkah. In Arabic, we call as the Fathu Makkah. Fath means the conquest. Fathu Makkah means the conquest of Makkah. In the previous episode, we saw what were the reasons for this battle to take place, for this conquest to take place. And we saw, to revise it, that a treaty was made between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people of Makkah that any sort of war activities would come to a halt for the next 10 years. But the Quraysh, they failed to keep up with the conditions of the treaty, and they helped the tribe of Banu Bakr with weapons and men in order to attack the tribe of Khuza'a, who were the allies of the Muslims, following which the Treaty of Hudaybiyah came to an end. Though Abu Sufyan tried his level best to persuade the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to keep up the treaty, however, many of the inexperienced youth of Makkah and a number of people in Makkah who were under the delusion that we could simply gain victory over the people of Medina, they went against Abu Sufyan. And similarly, the Muslims of Medina, along with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they did not accept the pleas of Abu Sufyan to continue with the treaty. So the treaty came to an end, and the fire of war was rekindled between Makkah and Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in utmost secrecy, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began the preparations of conducting an attack over the people of Makkah. And therefore he asked his Sahaba to gather an army, but the purpose of this army and the destination of this army was known to none but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when Hatib bin Abi Balta radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who estimated or guessed that perhaps the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to attack Makkah, and he wrote a letter which he sent with one of the women who was traveling to Makkah. When Hatib bin Abi Balta radiyallahu ta'ala anhu did this, and that lady was caught and brought back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hatib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu sought the pardon and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Though the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam considered what Hatib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu did to be wrong, yet he said to Umar bin Khattab, who wanted to strike the neck of Hatib, that, "O Umar, you do not know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked upon the faces of those who participated in the battle of Badr, and he said that do what you wish, for I have forgiven you." Hatib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was one of the righteous Sahaba. And the reason he did this, that he disclosed the secret of Medina to the people of Makkah, or was about to do it, was not because he had turned into an apostate, or that he was a friend of the people of Makkah, but there were some desires, there was a sort of fear in the heart of Hatib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu that overcame him, and therefore he committed this mistake, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of forgiving. And therefore, it is not permissible for any one of us to talk ill about Hatib radiallahu ta'ala anhu after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam remained silent and pardoned him. This is the place up till where we had taken last time. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then gathered his army and set out for Makkah. And one of the ways in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he kept his intention a secret, was that he sent a small army consisting of a few of the Sahaba to some of the other places. And it was a custom that whenever the larger army is about to go to any particular place, a smaller army first, it went to that place and acted like an eye of the larger army, the larger body of soldiers who were arriving behind them. So therefore, many of the people or the spies of Quraysh who might be tracking the movement of the Muslims, they were led into thinking that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has the intention to go to that particular place where that small army has gone, and the larger body of the Muslims would follow. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was of the intention that this army was simply, that small army was simply to divert the attention of the people, and the main focus, the main target, the final destination of that force of 10,000 Muslim soldiers that had set out from Makkah, from Medina, was none other than Makkah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam set out towards Makkah. On his way to Makkah, he met his uncle Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, who was arriving to Medina. Along with Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, there was another person, a cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, named Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith. Not Abu Sufyan, the chief of Makkah. He was Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. And this person who met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam here was Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, who was one of the paternal relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he had a history of gross animosity towards the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, though being a relative, a cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yet the time he had spent in Makkah and the relation that he had with the Muslims was filled with hatred and animosity in his speech, in his actions. Therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, and Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith wanted to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, though it was painful for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to see this man standing in front of him, who used to cause so much pain to the Muslims and to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But finally, when Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith, when he thought with a clear mind and he expressed his desire to embrace Islam in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pardoned him, and he accepted his alliance to the people of Medina, to Islam. And this was a display, and this was in fact the translation of the ayah of Surah Al-Anbiya, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. O Prophet of Allah, we have sent you not but as a mercy to the people of the worlds. This was the mercy, the generosity of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to his worst enemies. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then marched further until he reached a place known as Marr al-Zahran. While the Quraysh did not have the slightest hint of the arrival of an army of 10,000 soldiers. And this shows the military genius of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that an army of 10,000 marched all the way, the 500 to 600 kilometers from Medina, and has come so close to Makkah at Marr al-Zahran, which can be easily seen from Makkah, while the Quraysh did not have the slightest hint, the slightest clue of the arrival of an army of 10,000 soldiers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in order to display the strength of the Muslim army and in order to weaken the morale of the enemy, when it was night time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered the soldiers to ignite fires. Each soldier was to ignite a fire, and Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was made in charge of this activity. Finally, when the people of Makkah, who might be sleeping in their homes, when they saw on the horizon 10,000 fires stretching from the east to the west or from the north to the south, the people of Makkah, they were confused, they were amazed, astonished, fearful. 1,000 emotions rushed into their hearts at the same time. Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harb, the chief of Makkah, and along with him some others, they came out to inspect the situation. And they happened to meet Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who merged with the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he met him on the way. Abu Sufyan ibn Harb, he was having a conversation with the person who was along with him, probably Hakim bin Hizam or someone else, and they were discussing which army this was, or who are these people. And the companion of Abu Sufyan, he suggested that perhaps this is the tribe of Khuza'a who have come to avenge what we did to them. But Abu Sufyan, an experienced leader, he thought that Khuza'a are not powerful enough nor courageous enough to do such an act, to take such a courageous step. Abu Sufyan dismissed this suggestion. While Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the darkness of the night, he was able to make out that this is Abu Sufyan and his companion who are talking with each other. Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to them and he greeted them, Abu Sufyan and his companion. And then Abu Sufyan asked him, "Oh Abbas, what is this that I'm seeing?" Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he then said to Abu Sufyan, "This is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions. It's better for you that you embrace Islam." Abu Sufyan was shocked. Abu Sufyan was shocked, not knowing what to do, because to confront such an army on such a short notice that could easily swipe away Makkah was not possible. Abu Sufyan, in his astonishment, he questioned Al-Abbas, "Oh Abbas, what is the solution? Oh Abbas, what is the solution?" Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu then said, "The solution is that you surrender to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam." Al-Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu then made him ride the donkey or the mule of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in order to take him to the tent, to the camp where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was. And whenever they passed by a group of Muslims, and when they saw that this is Al-Abbas, and there's someone sitting on the donkey of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they did not bother to stop them and interrogate them. But finally, when they passed by Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was known for his intelligence, his strength, and his foresightedness, he stopped them. He stopped them and he said, "Abbas, who's this?" Finally, when Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he found out the identity of the person who's sitting on the donkey, and that it is Abu Sufyan, he was filled with the emotion, or he was filled with the thirst to take revenge on Abu Sufyan for all what he had done in the past 7 to 8 years and the 13 years in Makkah. Finally, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was excited to see Abu Sufyan in such a vulnerable position. No one to protect him, no pact, no treaty, not even a guarantee of safety that could assure the safety of the life of Abu Sufyan. Both of them rushed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abbas along with Abu Sufyan and Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu demanding a protection for Abu Sufyan, while Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu seeking the permission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to kill this arch enemy of Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent both of them away, telling Al-Abbas that, "Oh Abbas, keep Abu Sufyan with you and bring him to me in the morning." Finally, when Abu Sufyan, who had been an arch enemy of Islam, trying his level best, leaving no stone unturned in harming the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, throughout those years, he finally sat there, surrounded by the Sahaba, in that weak position, knowing, realizing his fears that he had once experienced in the court of the King Heraclius of Rome. When the Prophet ﷺ's letter had reached the king of Rome. And the king of Rome summoned Abu Sufyan, who happened to be there in Syria. At that time, Abu Sufyan had realized that the matter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has grown so much that even the king of Rome is afraid of him. From that time onwards, Abu Sufyan had developed this certainty in his heart that one fine day Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is definitely going to conquer over Makkah. And finally, he saw that fear with his own eyes when he sat there in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba surrounding him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, "O Abu Sufyan, has not the time come for you to accept the truth? There was an era when you were powerful and that power blinded you from accepting the truth. Has not the time come now that you attest, you acknowledge the truth and you embrace Islam?" This was the generosity of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is giving the enemies a chance to rethink, to reponder, and to come back to the right path. Abu Sufyan began praising the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with all that he knew, and of course he was speaking the truth, for even the enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they acknowledged the fact that if there is a righteous person on the face of this earth, the most righteous person, the most upright person, it is none other than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Abu Sufyan, he was reluctant to embrace Islam. Finally, Al-Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he ordered Abu Sufyan, "Oh Abu Sufyan, has not the time come for you to embrace Islam? Embrace Islam before your neck is struck with the sword." It was then that Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he took the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the servant, the slave, and the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." And then Islam became so strong in the heart of Abu Sufyan that it was just a few years later, in the battles with the Muslims fought under the caliphate of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu on the Roman fronts and on the Persian fronts, that Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was one of the most bravest soldiers, pledging to death while fighting the enemies. And what he did for the sake of Islam, the books of history are a witness to it. So Abu Sufyan finally embraced Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then asked Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu that when the army was marching, he was to take Abu Sufyan to one of the cliffs, to one of the small mountains, so that Abu Sufyan can have a view of the entire Muslim army. And one of the wisdom in doing such a thing was that even if there was a small hope in the people of Quraysh or in the heart of Abu Sufyan that they could give resistance to the Muslim army that was arriving, which would cause harm of course to the people of Quraysh and which would hinder the conquest or the conquest of the Muslims, in order to erase that hope, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu to take Abu Sufyan to one of the mountains so that he can have a view of the sea of soldiers who had surrounded Makkah. This can be one of the wisdoms which the writers of Seerah have mentioned. Al-Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu and Abu Sufyan, they both went up the mountain, and whenever a battalion passed by, a group of soldiers passed by, Abu Sufyan questioned Al-Abbas, "Oh Abbas, who are these people?" And Abbas said, "This is such and such tribe. This is such and such a tribe." Until there came the battalion, a heavily armored group of soldiers. Abu Sufyan then asked, "Who is this, O Abbas?" Al-Abbas said, "This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba." Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was about to return to Makkah, Abbas came and requested that, "O Prophet of Allah, Abu Sufyan is one of the chiefs of Makkah. And as it is the custom of the chiefs, or maybe a trait of Abu Sufyan, that he loves to boast. He loves honor, Abu Sufyan. And which person does not love honor? Abu Sufyan, he had an immense love for honor. So, O Prophet of Allah, why not you give some honor to Abu Sufyan?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then said that, "O Abu Sufyan, announce in Makkah that whoever, when the army enters Makkah, Whoever goes in the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. Whoever goes into his home and locks his door is safe. Whoever goes to the Masjid al-Haram, he is safe. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a specific mention of the house of Abu Sufyan in that announcement in order to honor Abu Sufyan. And this shows that Islam has come not to degrade people. Islam has come not to degrade people, but in fact when a person embraces Islam, Islam raises him in honor. Abu Sufyan, his chieftain, the fact that Abu Sufyan was the chief of Makkah, he was not robbed of that honor. He was retained as the chief of Makkah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him excess honor in addition to the honor which he already had. Finally, when Abu Sufyan returned to Makkah and he made this announcement in front of the people that, oh people, there is no option in front of you except that you surrender to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he made that announcement that whoever enters the sacred mosque, his life shall be spared. Whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan, his life shall be spared. The people asked him that, oh Abu Sufyan, will your house be sufficient for all of the people? And then he further said, whoever enters his home and he locks his doors, he is safe. The army shall not disturb him. The army shall not do any sort of harm to him. This is what Abu Sufyan announced in Makkah, and his announcement had a profound effect on the people of Makkah, who rushed to their homes. Some rushed to the sacred mosque in order to make way for the conquerors to enter Makkah. However, always there's a group of people, the brothers of Shaitan, who want to put up resistance to the final stage. Even though they know that they are going to lose, they are ready to fight the truth up till their last breath. And there was this group present in Makkah, Safwan bin Umayyah, Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl, and some others. They, rather than obeying Abu Sufyan and thinking with a clear and wise mind, they gathered some of their people, they took their armor, and they hid in some of the places in order to attack the Muslim army when it enters Makkah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the other hand, he spent the time planning how the army would enter Makkah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu ta'ala anhu as the leader of the right wing of the army, and he appointed Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu ta'ala anhu as the leader of the left wing of the army. Khalid was to enter Makkah through its lower side, whereas Zubayr bin Awwam radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was to enter Makkah from its upper side. And he made Abu Ubaida ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu the leader of the infantry. And this was the designed plan of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to conquer over Makkah. And there were strict instructions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam not to cause harm to anyone, nor to shed the blood of anyone, except for the one who shows resistance. If there's some person who's showing any form of resistance and stopping the army from entering, he was to be killed. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he led his group of soldiers from the upper part of Makkah, and he faced no resistance of any form until he reached the place appointed to him by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he placed the banner of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on that place. And so did Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. However, Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu ta'ala anhu did face some resistance from Safwan bin Umayyah and Ikrimah. However, soon Khalid radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was able to overpower them. Some of them were killed, and many of them, they fled for their lives, including Safwan and Ikrimah. And two Muslims as well were martyred in this incident. Finally, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam reached Makkah, after he rested for a while, along with some of his companions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam proceeded to the Kaaba. And it is worthy to mention over here the difference in the attitude of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the different conquerors whom we have seen in history. We have usually seen in history that when kings, they enter new cities, they degrade the people of that city. They boast about themselves. They show their pride, they show off their wealth, they enter with a head raised up high, boasting in all ways possible. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he taught the Muslims that if there is something which is necessary on occasions of happiness, on occasions when blessings are raining from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is that a Muslim must remain humble, down to earth, and his tongue should be moistened with the remembrance and thanks and the words of gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unlike the other kings before him, he did not chant verses boasting about his bravery, his courage, his achievements. In fact, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came into Makkah, his head was lowered, as if he was feeling the immense burden of the blessings which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. As if he came like a humble slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone until he entered Makkah. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had said in the hadith, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. Strange is the matter of a believer, and this is indeed strange, for a person to remain humble in times of happiness, in times of joy, in times where things seem to go in favor of him, to remain humble in that time is indeed strange. And therefore the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, strange is the matter of a believer, إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءُ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءُ صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. When something good happens to him, he thanks Allah, which is good for him. If something bad happens to him, he's patient, which is good for him. So a Muslim is always in a win-win situation. If there's something bad, he gets the reward for being patient. If there's something good, he earns the reward of gratefulness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then continued his march towards the Kaaba. Towards the Kaaba, the same Kaaba where the Muslims once wanted to pray, but the leaders of Quraysh stopped them from praying over there. The same Kaaba where the weak and the poor Muslims were tortured. The same Kaaba where if a person wanted to say La ilaha illallah, 360 idols were placed by the people of Quraysh over there, and they laughed at him saying, أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. Has he made all these gods into one single god? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam marched towards that Kaaba from where he had once called out, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ تُفْلِحُ. Say La ilaha illallah and you shall be successful. But the people had mocked at him. He marched towards that Kaaba, finally entered the Kaaba, and he began to knock the idols one by one. He began to erase the pictures which the people had painted on the walls of Kaaba or had engraved on the walls of Kaaba. There were pictures which depicted Ibrahim alayhi salam, the leader of the Muwahideen, and his son Ismail as practicing divination. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam rejected all of that and said, Ibrahim and Ismail, they did not do all of that which has been portrayed in those paintings. He knocked down all of the idols, erased all of those images, and said while he was doing this, قُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. Truth has come and falsehood has perished, for falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. After cleaning the Kaaba of all of the idols, of all of the images, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then came out to the people, and then various incidents took place while the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in Makkah. From the narrations of the hadith, we see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he also made two rakahs of salah in the Kaaba. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he did tawaf of the Kaaba, and he also prayed two rakat salah in the Kaaba after it was cleaned and purified. And the people who were there along with him, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, were Usama ibn Zayd radiyallahu ta'ala anhu and Bilal ibn Abi Rabah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam prayed in the Kaaba, and also one of the notable incidents that took place was the speech which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave to the people of Quraysh. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam addressed the people of Quraysh saying, there's no God but Allah alone, he has no associates. He made good his promise that he held to his servant and helped him and defeated all the confederates alone. Bear in mind that every claim of privilege, whether that of blood or property is under my heel, except that of the custody of Al-Kaaba, and supplying water to the pilgrims, bear in mind that for anyone who is slain, even though semi-deliberately, with a club or a whip, for him the blood money is very severe, 100 camels, 40 of them to be pregnant. And this perhaps was in context to one of the incidents that took place, that some people of Khuza'ah, in order to take revenge of some of their past hostilities, they killed some innocent people. And in this context, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said these words. And then he also said, Ya ma'shara Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَذْهَبَ عَنْكُمْ نَخْوَةَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ وَتَعْظِيمَهَا بِالْآبَاءِ النَّاسُ مِنْ آدَمُ وَآدَمُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. O people of Quraysh, surely Allah has abolished from you all pride of the pre-Islamic era, all pride in your ancestry. All men are descendants of Adam, and Adam was made out of dust. And then he recited the ayah of Surah Al-Hujurat, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. That, O mankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female, and we have made you into nations and tribes so that you may recognize each other, not that you may boast over each other. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Indeed, the most honored of you in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the most taqwa, who is the most righteous, who is the most pious, who is the most God-fearing amongst you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. Indeed, Allah is all-knowing, all-aware. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam trampled all forms of racism that were prevalent in that society under his feet. Not only was this a verbal announcement, but this was in display for the people. For when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came, the one riding behind him was Usama bin Zayd, who was the son of Zayd, and Zayd was a freed slave. The one who entered the Kaaba along with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who had spent a decade of slavery in the streets of Makkah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not only through his words showed the people the criteria for honor, the criteria for privilege, in fact through his actions he taught the people of Quraysh that a person is not to be judged based on his color or his ancestry. In fact, it is the abilities of a person that make him either honored or give him the opposite. And not only this, but also one of the incidents that point out that the criteria, the new standards which Islam had set, were now changed. From the pre-Islamic days, and Islam had brought a new set of standards to give to the world, was the incident of the adhan which Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu gave in Makkah. Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who had once been tortured in Makkah, who was looked down upon even before he embraced Islam as an Abyssinian slave, who was not even an Arab, in addition to that he was a slave, and who had been tortured through the streets of Makkah. Finally, when it was the time for Salah, it was Bilal who climbed up in the presence of different Sahaba, in the presence of the chieftains of Quraysh. Bilal climbed up the Kaaba in order to give the Adhan. And he pronounced the Adhan in Makkah, the call to Tawheed, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It was a very significant sight for the people of Makkah. As for those who had an inclination to Islam, they immediately embraced Islam on seeing this sight, that Islam gives honor to people based on their righteousness, based on their abilities. Whereas there were some other people of Makkah who had a hatred to Islam, who were astonished by this sight. How can this slave Bilal climb over the Kaaba and give the Adhan, which was something unimaginable in pre-Islamic Arabia or in the Makkah before the conquest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, whether it be for the people who loved this sight or whether it be for the people who hated this sight, one thing was unanimously agreed upon, that now the pre-Islamic customs, the customs that had been prevalent in Makkah throughout Arabia, the boasting of people based on their forefathers, the a degrading of people based on their forefathers. All of that was now under the feet of Islam, and the criteria is justice. The criteria for honor and privilege is not someone's color or ancestry, it is his piety, it is the action that he does. These were some of the incidents that took place when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conquered over Makkah. There were some other more interesting incidents inshallah, which we shall see in the coming episodes. Up till then, fi amanillah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.